Welcome to Main Street, a very special Main Street Gamers podcast. I'm Chris Ingles.
I'm Taylor Davis, but I'm excited.
I'm excited too, because, folks, we got our hands on the Xbox One. We played the games, we felt the controller.
No.
I massaged the Kinect.
How'd you do that?
Actually. Same Peggle too. And we're here to talk about it.
Yeah.
That's what we're gonna do. It's gonna be
get excited, people.
Probably a very long time of us talking about it. So, Davis, how do you want to start this off? Do you want to talk about your favorite game first, or do you want to run down the games that we played first, and then at the end talk about our favorite, most like hand out some awards?
Yeah, let's do that. Let's just let them know what's up, what we did, what
right.
we played.
So, let's talk about the controller first, because I feel like that's kind of everybody's big.
That's where it's all gonna start.
I gotta be honest, I was kind of disappointed in the controller.
Hit that convenience store to the left.
Okay.
Real quick.
The controller is definitely a lot better. Don't get me wrong. When I say I was disappointed, it's a lot better. Like it's significantly improved over the last.
Lighter. One. Like there's no.
Lighter. I love the way this is gonna sound so stupid. I love the way the thumbsticks feel.
Yeah, they feel nice.
They're like dipped in really nicely, so your fingers kind of like lock in there nicely.
And what they did is they made the stick smaller, the D-pad smaller. It's not like clunky or anything. It's really precise. And what they did is they really just tightened everything up. So it's like imagine holding my 360 controller right now. Imagine if you just like pushed hard enough and just like squished it in, and then took the back away. And you just get smoked by that car.
Okay. So
it's really
the controller
it's,
feels really nice.
It's a lot tighter. It's a lot more precise, and it feels a lot better in hand.
I had a few minor gripes with it. The bumpers I don't think feel as natural as they do on the 360 controller.
That's probably the best way to describe it. They feel
they're a little jagged.
They're like sharp almost. Like they're really edgy.
Maybe it was just in the little time we had with it, but the transition from the triggers to the bumpers did not feel as smooth as it does on the 360.
It almost felt like they were in the way.
I mean, I didn't really get that feeling. I just thought it was really uncomfortable to switch between the triggers and the bumpers. And, like, think about when you're playing a game like Call of Duty, you do that a lot to, like, throw grenades and use your secondary. And, like, there's a couple games where you do that a lot that I don't know how that's going to feel. Maybe we'll get used to it. Maybe we're just so used to the 360 controller and locked into that that...
Yeah, obviously that's the biggest deal.
We'll see. And while the D-pad is much improved, it still kind of feels like one big disc that they just kind of hit a little bit better. I mean, we didn't get a super ton of time with it, but it still doesn't feel... like it's much better, like don't get me wrong, but I feel like they still could have done it better.
Like going diagonal with it is like perfect now. Like, you can feel the difference, but it's still like you said, it's still a circle, which I don't like. It should have.
I don't know why they can't do.
It should have been separated. It should have been separated. That's what I think.
Yeah.
But otherwise, it feels awesome in your hand. Really light.
It's gonna be a controller that you can hold on to for 12 hours, which I
am
very happy about.
And the thing is, like, we can already do that with a 360 controller, so like, it's not like a huge, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's not a huge deal. Yeah.
Like how I explained it, I tweeted a picture of like me holding it, and I was like, basically, perfection got better.
Yeah, it's still. I mean, we haven't held the PS4 controller yet, but. I would be very surprised if it beats, if I think the PS4 controller feels better than the 360 one, or the Xbox One, because it feels so good.
It's a stick for preference, too. Like, that's the biggest thing, like, where you want to hold your stick. Because I was playing PS3 this weekend, too, and it took me a while to get used to going back to the sticks being down. And,
yeah, it's a very... I think just the way
it's
the stick layout of the Xbox, it's very much, very, very more, very, very more natural feeling.
So
definitely get excited about the controller. The next thing I actually kind of wanted to talk about was I kind of wanted to launch into just some general thoughts on the games. And we're going to start with one that we were both pretty impressed with, and that's Ryse.
Yeah, so going into this event, Ryse was the game that I really wanted to get my hands on and I really wanted to spend some time with, because from what I've seen, I was not, I was excited for it, but I have a lot, I had a lot of doubts about it. All those were gone.
They were leaving almost instantly.
Yeah, it looks amazing. The type of game it is, it works really well as a type of game it is.
So they've been criticized a lot.
How you explained it.
Yeah, they've been criticized a lot for how the combat feels, and like the combat is definitely like not anything crazy, but it's basically the exact same combat of Batman Arkham City and Arkham Asylum, a game that's been constantly praised for its fighting mechanics.
Don't get in the back. Here's the thing. I know I've said in the past that I'm like, oh, can't wait for another QuickTime event game. Guess what? I didn't do a single QuickTime when I played.
I mean, you do. They just mask it so well that you don't even...
QuickTime
events, basically. But
literally,
it never feels like it.
No, it's not monotonous. It's like every single time I kill somebody, I feel it. And I was like, that was the only game that I truly got into it. Like, I was rolling with the punches and stuff because, like... So
yeah,
what
I definitely
we've seen,
felt myself like leaning and like poking and pulling from side to side.
That was the only game that did that. And what we've seen of it, it was the arena co-op.
It's sort of like a challenge mode, right? I think
it's the arena co-op game mode is what we played, but it was by yourself. They didn't let us cooperate with anybody else. And so what it is your gladiator goes out in the arena. Think of it kind of like Spartacus, if you know what that is. You go out and you have the ability to I don't know if you notice it, but in the upper left hand corner there's a meter that is how well your crowd is invested in you, like if you're like if they're excited or not, and that really captured like the arena feel, because that's what it was about back then, like the glory of the arena. So you
and
can,
not
you
all can, the game is going to be like that though, right? Isn't
no
of it,
there's
like,
a
just
definitely
straight up battle?
There's a Yeah, there's a definite single-player campaign
okay.
experience, but this
but
is
yeah,
just from what we played.
It was fantastic.
And what happens?
I cannot
is,
stress enough. I mean, it's QuickTime events. Like, don't get me wrong, but it feels so seamless that you don't
notice. I understand what you're saying about QuickTime events, but let's not give people like the wrong idea, because like you enter this arena. And then there's a
yeah, but one of the
goal.
Reasons I was so successful in the game when I played the demo, like a lot of people were failing out because they didn't understand how to play it.
I know,
like,
but
it's one of those games where you just sit back and wait. Like, it's not gonna be a game where you just run and hack and slash. Okay, go for it.
So you go into the arena, and then like for us, there's just a specific task, which was the first one was to kill all the like barbarians or whatever they call. So like our dude, we had a shield and a sword. And what happens is X is your light attack, Y is your like heavy attack, like normal, or it's like Y is your bash attack with your shield. So
and you can hold Y as well to do like a clearance attack.
Yeah, so guys will run up to you, and what it is it's a rhythm fighting game. Like that's.
Oh, that's a good like, description for it. I like that.
You know, because in battle, that's essentially what it is. Like you have to find a rhythm in battle to like obviously conquer your enemies. So like if a guy's gonna swing at you. There's ability to hit. I think it was A, wasn't it? Like that was the counter ability.
The A. Okay, so A is like a block, basically.
Yeah, A was your counter block ability. So what you did is like people would come up to you. It really reminded me a lot of Assassin's Creed combat, because like somebody would
oh,
come
that's
up
true
to you.
Too. Yep, definitely.
You would hit A to counter that guy, and then you would turn around and bash his buddy's face in that wasn't like prepared for it because he's farther away, and then you would do the ability where. So once you hit a guy a couple times, a little skull would pop above their head, and that allowed you to go into execution mode, and you would hold right trigger, and the freaking executions on the game were fantastic. Because you would just like go up to them and just stab somebody like through their chin and stuff. And
did you notice you could change?
Bashing and stuff.
You could change how the execution went by pressing different buttons at different points in it.
And what it does, and it's in like. It's definitely a quick time, but like a obnoxious
it's not
quick time, X
though, that
doesn't.
Was not.
You know, like that's what I'm saying. Like quick time is like an obnoxious X will pop up on your screen. You have to bash it. No, it's like there's a slight vibration in the controller, and then that's when you hit a button, and that's how you murder that person. Like that's
and another really cool feature of that sort of like execution mode is. It allows you to unlock, like, you unlock the executions when you do them for the first time. But, like, I'm sure there's going to be an achievement that's, like, perform all the executions. You know,
yeah,
like,
and there's going to be...
Because there's so many different possibilities, like... Because there were several different starting positions and several different things you could do during the executions. It was, like, a really great experience.
And then another thing is, when you enter, before you enter the arena, you get ability to choose between... I think there's four gods in this demo. You choose ability of each god. And some of the ability... Like, the ability I picked was the ability to slow down time. I know... I think you picked the fire one, right? Which just does fire
like
damage. There's a fire damage. There's another one that allows you to... Crap, what was it? Slow down time, a fire damage. I think there was like a defense.
Health regeneration.
Yeah, health regeneration. And then just like ability to like counter or something like that. It was like the four gods.
One thing I really want to see from that game is whether or not you can use a bow and arrow. Because...
Well, yeah, we've seen javelin toss.
So in the demo we played, we got to throw a javelin. And it was a pretty cool targeting system, I thought. And the javelin throw was really cool where...
The physics was really accurate.
Yep, you threw it in one direction, and it went that way no matter what. So what ended up happening was, even if you threw it for a guy's head and somebody ran in front, that person still took it. So I had a really cool moment where I was trying to throw it at one of, like, the Minotaurs, but one of the barbarians, which were sort of like the weaker enemies, like, accidentally ran in front, and I just caught him right in the face.
Nice,
and
dude.
It was pretty cool. Because, like, I feel like in a lot of games, you're, like, locked into one opponent where if you shoot at one person, no one can get in the way of the bullet. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it was, like, one of the nice little improvements we're seeing, you know, in sort of, like, going to the next gen. So that was kind of nice to see.
So I'm definitely picking up Ryse now at launch. I'm 100% sold on it.
It's sold on in, like, 5 minutes of gameplay.
Yeah, just from that demo, man. And, like...
I was very, very impressed. Like, we had heard a lot of negative things in the media, and I don't know if it was just because of the E3 demo that didn't come off that great, but
yeah.
Every indication is that this game is going to be a pretty, pretty solid fighting game, and just a great action-adventure game as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so moving on, the next game I kind of wanted to talk about is Forza.
So that's the first game we played, right?
Yeah, that was like my first... Yeah. I thought it would look the best. That's why I wanted to do that one first.
Yeah.
Is because I was like, oh, this is going to be the game that looks the best, so what we're going to do is we're going to watch this one. We're going to do this one first, and we're going to be like, oh, stunned by how it looks. And I got to be honest, it didn't really live up to that billing.
No, I was not stunned by it at all.
It looked good. Like, don't get me wrong. It looked good by current console generation standards, of course. It looks amazing. But comparatively between some of the other games we saw, and we'll talk about this a little bit later as well, I didn't think it was the best looking game we saw.
No, not at all. And like, when it comes to Forza as a racing game, if you want to sit there and hit the left trigger a bunch, I guess that's a game for you. Like, that's not a racing game for me. Like, when I play racing games,
we've talked about this before.
I go balls to the wall, handbrake.
Exactly.
Like, that's how I play. That's how I want to play racing games. Not sit in a super souped-up car and have to slow down and actually, like, race.
Yeah,
like,
that's...
legit. But
part of the reason we didn't like this game as much as we could have was because neither one of us are real fans of this franchise for that exact reason, that we prefer, like, the arcadey racers, and, like, that's...
Yeah.
It's like not a gripe against the game, not a gripe against us. It just is the way it is. It's just the games we prefer. And I mean, Forza was. I thought it was technically really great. Like, I felt the physics were awesome. The driving felt really natural. Like, it felt like you were driving your car down the street.
Yeah,
and
it's
another
a great
thing about it. Another great thing about it was the integration of the rumble triggers.
Yeah, this is the only time
on the new controller.
Really got to feel that.
Yeah, I mean, it worked a little bit in Dead Rising, but it was really the only time we got to feel the new rumble triggers, and let me tell you, they felt great. You felt the pull of the car around the corners, you felt that slight tug of the brake in your hands, and it was fantastic.
Yeah, it's like,
that was my favorite part of that
experience.
Game, to be honest with you.
Yeah, definitely, that was the only reason. That was pretty much the only reason I really wanted to play. All right, we gotta get out of here. Pick me up.
Alright, so... The next game I'd like to... Do you have anything else to say about Forza? Kind of was what it was, right?
Yeah, I mean...
Diehard Forza fans are going to love it. People who don't
absolutely.
Like Forza aren't going to like it.
Great job, by the way. on getting this car completely wedged in between this rock. Oh my god. Best getaway driver ever. So yeah, Forza, there's nothing that should surprise you.
Yeah,
I mean,
like,
just from what the demo we seen. We didn't see, it was just a race and you gotta pick different cars. So
it looks really good. It's not the best looking game that we saw. It looks really good.
If you don't own a car in real life and can't physically go out and drive, I guess you can pick up Forza. Because that's pretty much a realistic experience you're going to get.
So, truly all we have to say about that one. The next game I wanted to talk about was FIFA, actually. And I'm just going to kind of take the reins on this one because you're not a big FIFA guy, but I am. FIFA fans, you will definitely be very, very happy with this game. It's basically it plays the same as.
Do you want me to drive?
No, I got it. It plays the same as the current gen version of the game, so you're not like any new surprises as far as gameplay is concerned. What there is a lot of added animations, but the biggest upgrade in this game is how it looks. I think it was the best looking game we saw.
Probably.
The crowd was what I was fascinated with. The crowd, everyone looks like they are seriously, like, it looks like a crowd at a soccer match. It looked fantastic. There was a little bit of an issue with the demo we saw of, like, the field looking a little dark and the players looking a little dark. Especially when they got into, like, sort of that shadowy area that FIFA players will be familiar with. But I think that was mainly because of the fact that some sort of setting on the TV. Like, I really think that they didn't get the TV calibrated correctly. Which was a shame, because I would have liked to see it, like, in a well-lit environment, but it looked superb. Like, outside of the shadowy area, everything looked magnificent. I really, really enjoyed it. There's several new animations that make it look and feel more like soccer than ever before. I would highly recommend it to anyone who is a fan of soccer or even a fan of any sports games. Like, I'm definitely picking it up at launch. It exceeded my expectations tenfold. I thought it was fantastic. It's everything I could have wanted FIFA to be on the next gen.
Yeah, and it felt really tight.
It did. The controls feel so tight with it.
Yeah.
And especially with the added bonus of getting the legends for legendary soccer players are going to be exclusive to the Xbox One. It's going to be
make
it an even better experience. I'm still surprised that they were able to score that, because that's a pretty cool. It's like all the Ultimate Team stuff relies heavily on Legends now, so.
And the fact they were also able to make this is fantastic. We should mention that if you let's grab a chopper. If you isn't that game launching in Europe with the Xbox?
Oh yeah, it is bundled with the Xbox.
Take a right. Let's go grab that chopper back there. If you're listening to this, just listening to it, we are playing Grand Theft Auto, and Chris is driving like a maniac, and it's really
we tried to take
upsetting.
A more casual approach to the special.
Yeah, well, we try to go casual, and then we get a 3-star wanted level with a terrible getaway driver who wedges a car, and we're taking this plan.
Yep.
Face plan. But, yeah, so that was FIFA.
The next game, we're going into one more here. I'm flying 100%. Next game I wanted to talk about was Killer Instinct.
Killer Instinct, yeah, we played each other in that. Probably one of my most clutch moments in gaming ever took place there.
You had like 1% health and you finished
took
me off
you
at like 20.
Out with the werewolf guy, whatever his name is.
It was very upsetting. What did you think of the game?
Felt like a side 2D fighter.
Yeah, okay, so it looked, first of all, it looked gorgeous. It looked amazing.
Yeah, it looked pretty good.
It's really hard to tell how good a fighting game is going to be from a media demo, because
I can't even tell you what a good fighting game is.
Well, I mean, it's so tough to tell from the combat system, because we couldn't do it. We don't know enough about it to do the combos. Oh!
You die.
Yeah, I crashed into a police helicopter. We don't know enough about the combat system to do fighting. You know, you couldn't do any combos. You didn't really know any of the special moves.
Yeah,
it was really hard to. We're just trying to kind of get a feel for it. And let me tell you, it feels tight. The controller works really well with it. It looks really good. It's going to be a really popular game at launch because It's, I mean, people love 2D fighters. It's not really my
free, thing. Right? Isn't Killer Instinct free?
You get one character for free to play with, and then the other ones are like, it's like free to play.
I won't be spending time with it. I mean, if you're a fan of the 2D fighters, I mean, it's definitely, you should be
Because it's the only one that's launching with any of the consoles. So if you're a fan of 2D fighters, you're getting the Xbox One, and you're getting Killer Instinct with it. Like, it's just the way it goes, so. Killer Instinct, I was a fan of, but like I said, it's really tough to know what the combat system is.
People know the combos and stuff. I clutched it. That was definitely exciting for me to beat you in it. That was awesome.
Yeah. Next, we're going to have a little... We'll talk about the Xbox Live Arcade games. We're going to transition into that a little bit. So we tried Peggle 2.
Yeah, we did.
Peggle 2 is Peggle 1. It looks good. We didn't really... We played the first world. A couple levels from the first world.
Was there anything even added to it?
See, that's the thing. Like, we only played the first world, and the first world is always Bjorn, who's that unicorn guy.
Yeah.
So, like, there's probably new characters, new abilities, new modes, but, like, from what we saw, we only saw the opening sequence, which is always kind of the same on Peggle, so...
But it was fun.
But, yeah, like I said, it's a ton of fun. I actually still don't think Peggle is a game that lends itself to the Xbox very well. The mouse is a much more precise way to control. And maybe they'll have different control options, but the control option on the demo was you had to, like, you aimed where you shot. Which sounds alright, but, like, it really was tough to be precise with your shots. Whereas if they do, like, a left to right control mechanic, it'll be a much more smooth experience to allow you to get those precise shots, especially when you have Bjorn's special ability, which is like the able to see exactly where you're shooting. It'll be much better if they do like a left-right control mechanic where you move the cannon left to right based on the D-pad or thumbstick.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
It looked really good. It's Peggle. I mean, they're not reinventing the wheel.
Wow. This is pretty funny.
You're just kind of playing the Peggle again.
This is fantastic.
But Peggle was such a great game, like, you don't...
Yeah, don't like fix what's not broken,
don't
right?
Don't fix something that's not broken. And they're not doing that. Peggle fans can rest easy. It's not, it's not Diablo 3.
Hopefully there'll be some co-op in there.
Yeah, well...
You think that could
co-op
work?
Or head-to-head, I think, would be fun as well.
Head-to-head would be fun, yeah. What if it was like, imagine a head-to-head mode where you're shooting at each other's, like, like, bricks, you know? And it's like whoever just,
What I think is cool is it would be cool if they did alternate shots, most points. Would be kind
of
cool.
That would be also a great mode. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff they can do with it.
But then you'd have to, like, you'd want to get as many more points than your opponent, but you'd still kind of have to help each other out to, like, unlock, like, bigger clumps of, like, good brick.
That would be really interesting. That'd be fun.
Yeah, well, it's a really fun strategy, like, game. Because there would be games where, like, 10 bricks would get broken because you wouldn't want to, like, open up a new area for your opponent where they were going to get a ton of points. That's my idea for the best Peggle multiplayer. That was Peggle. Another game we got to try was Loco Cycle. Loco Cycle is the Twisted Pixel game. Twisted Pixel were the guys that made Explosion Man, I believe. For their last venture.
Yeah.
And I was kind of excited for this game, but it was, I mean, it's kind of lackluster. It doesn't have very much character.
What Ingles is trying to say is it's awful.
It's not awful.
Boring. I did not enjoy it.
It's kind of boring.
All.
My biggest problem with the game is
it looked like crap.
Didn't look great. I mean, my biggest problem with the game. I don't want to bash it too hard, because, like...
Well, I'm going to bash it, because that's what it is. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but, like,
it was,
I mean,
I didn't,
you kind of have to...
I stopped playing it.
When
I was
buying,
holding
like,
an Xbox One controller, playing a next-gen game that's not even out yet, and I put it down.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at with both.
So, my biggest problem with this game was there's two kind of distinct sort of, like, gameplay mechanics.
Backflip.
One where you're fighting with the...
You mean X or B? That is the gameplay mechanics.
Okay, so when you press X, you are, like, fighting. You're, like, the motorcycle...
You're a freaking... You're not even... First off, you're not even riding the motorcycle. You're getting drugged by your feet, and you're controlling the motorcycle more than you are the... You don't control the person at all. You control the motorcycle.
So, okay, so let me explain this here.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm done.
To the listeners who haven't got to try
it. I'm done riding. It sucks.
Okay, so...
All right, I'm done.
There are places where you have to, like, punch the other vehicles, but with the X button. But then there are also places where you have to press B to shoot at other vehicles. But they really don't make any sort of distinction as to which is which. So you don't know at any time if you're supposed to press B or X to, like, shoot the guy or to punch him. But, like, it gets really confusing because you're like, oh, this guy, it wants me to punch this guy, but I have no way of knowing that. Whereas the next three vehicles that'll pull up, you're supposed to shoot. So that was a very, very annoying gameplay mechanic. We'll have to see if they find some way to fix that. I don't really know if there's any way to fix that. I think that's
just
how it is.
Dumb game. Did you get to the part where there's like these?
That up.
Yeah. Did you get to the part where there's like these twin things that are like shooting lasers in the road, and you gotta dodge the lasers and you gotta drive fast to get up to them.
Yeah.
And then you hit A a bunch of times and you kill him.
Yep.
That was the only thing that changed. Otherwise, you're driving down the same terrible-looking road, either hitting X or B.
Well, it was really tough in a game, in a day where we played a bunch of really, really nice, really great-looking games that had really awesome gameplay mechanics. It was really tough to go from those to go to these arcade games. But even then, it didn't feel like the other ones struggled as much as that one.
Yeah, but it was still a bad game compared to
the other ones. That was probably the only one that we didn't really like, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean,
we'll keep going.
Crimson. Next one.
Next game we're going to talk about is Crimson Dragon. And
so imagine Loco Cycle, but in the air.
Okay, no, I actually like this game. Because it's like Panzer Dragon Ordo, which is one of my favorite things. One of my favorite games as a kid, just because it's silly. But, like, you have to know what you're getting into. It's an on-rail shooter. It looks pretty good. It didn't look as great as some of the other things we saw. It looks pretty good. The gameplay is fine. Like, if you know what you're getting into, you're playing
boring.
Like, just because you don't like on-rail shooters doesn't mean the next person won't.
I know, but just, like...
It was a decent on-rail shooter.
I guess there's a lot, like... It looks like there's a lot going on in the menus and stuff, and, like, this is just, like, a particular mission, and, like, a particular dragon, and maybe you get cooler dragons down the road, and that would be cool. Well, from, like, what we played,
and there was all kinds
like,
of, like, different abilities and stuff, but
well,
you're right.
It's
kind of bland. It was kind of bland.
Because you can't even really, like, you don't get a, it's not an open world. Your dragon is drugged through a route, like a rail, and then you just, you can go left and right on the screen, and you hit X to shoot the one thing, or you can shoot your other gun. But, I didn't really, it wasn't my cup of tea. But,
if you like on-rail shooters, you might enjoy this one. I probably won't pick this one up just because there'll be so many things at launch. Like maybe in a couple, it'll be the first games with gold probably for the Xbox One. So
yeah, I can see that.
Like the first two are gonna be Loco Cycle and Crimson Dragon. And
here's
like
a lackluster. Here's some last luck.
I'm calling it right now. I'm calling it right now. July 2014. E3, or June 2014, E3, they're going to be like, and today, we're going to announce that we're resuming Games with Gold on the Xbox One. The first game available right now is Loco Cycle. And then starting June 15th, you'll be able to download Crimson Dragon.
Can we just stop? You're already upset. Because it's going to happen.
That's exactly what's
going to
happen.
I know, it just disappoints me.
All right, let's move on to something that... Oh!
No, let's one more.
I'm bringing that up right now. Max, The Curse of Brotherhood.
Fantastic game.
Really, really enjoyed this one.
Game you've most likely not heard of. And the only reason we noticed it was in I'd imagine so. We played it. We played it with all their other launch games. We seen a platformer in one of the videos before we actually got to play it. And we were like, what's that game? And then we managed to play it. And it's called Max, Curse of Brotherhood.
The Curse of Brotherhood, yep.
Yeah, Curse of Brotherhood. And
we don't know anything about the story. We just kind of got to play a couple levels of it.
What we did, though, is it's a cartoon. I mean,
public
it's
platformer.
Like, and what it is you are Max, and you have this, you find this magical pen, which is basically your superpower in the game. And what you do is you get to a point where, like, there's an obstacle, like, Max physically himself can't get by, and you hold right trigger, which brings out a pen, and the first ability was to, you hit A?
Control the land, yep.
Yeah, so you hold right trigger, and then you get to move the pen around, like, all over the screen, wherever you want, using left stick, and then you hold, and then you hit A on a certain mound in the land, and then that allows it to raise up a, the ground raises up in like a plateau thing, and it pushes like this rock out of the way, and then you hit X to break it so you can move on. So that was the first pen, and then I managed to get a little bit further into the level I got to play, and I actually you're up in like a jungle, you're climbing through trees, and you actually go into this little area, and you get a second pen, which is green this time. And that allows you to pull vines out of the walls, which allow you to jump and climb on the vines to get up to higher places. And then there's like little hidden collectibles that if you backtrack and redo your vines to draw them differently, you're able to pick up those collectibles. So that was really unique. I really liked it. I don't know
how I really enjoyed it as well.
The story's gonna work into it, but
a game like that, it really doesn't matter though, right?
No,
I mean,
it really
you're playing
doesn't.
It for the gameplay. So, like, if the story's crap, it's crap, but...
Dude, I really enjoy it.
I've been thinking about this a lot, actually, because this is one of the games that we had no idea it was there. We didn't really see it coming, and it was a really great experience. I had two major concerns with this game, like, two major things about this game. And they're not, like, bad things. They're just, like, things they should have done. One, how does the pen not work with the Kinect? How do you not use the Kinect to do that stuff?
Maybe it does, but they don't want to demo it.
Oh, that's a good point. But you know what I mean? How easy would it be to, like, have your pointer finger out and, like, swipe up the trees and, like, cut down the rocks and, like...
That would be a perfect use of the Kinect. Absolutely perfect. It would make sense. It wouldn't be annoying because you'd still hold the left... You'd hold your controller in your left hand and then you'd take your right hand with a pen and then, you know, swipe it. And then, I guess the only difficult thing about that would be how would you distinguish between... You making a vine or cutting it? You know what I'm saying?
Maybe a closed finger forward or pointed or made like a closed fist. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, closed fist. Maybe like knock stuff away. If you have your hand open, you can build stuff. Maybe, but maybe there's just so many pens in that game with so many different things that they could incorporate. You know, maybe. Yeah. But I mean, if they could make it happen,
that's
why
like
wouldn't
my
they?
first like thing about it. My second that's thing about it is they really should have chosen another art style.
You think so? You didn't like the art style?
I like the art style, but people are going to write it off as a kid's game.
Ooh.
And I don't think it's made for kids. I mean, kids can play it, but it's too tough for kids to play it, right?
Let me counter this argument, but, like, well, I guess, no, this was supported. You see, it's too difficult for kids. I watched probably a 50-year-old man sit in front of the first rock and hit right trigger and then not hit right trigger. And then hit right trigger, and then still didn't know what to do, and then not hit right trigger, and then he went back to hit right trigger again, and then go right trigger, and then I sat there for like 15 minutes and watched him do it, waiting to play the game.
Out. Yeah.
And I was like, dude, what are you doing?
It
wasn't even
like
that difficult. Like, there's an obvious thing that comes up on the map.
Well, I consider myself a platformer pro, and I died like 15 times in one level.
Yeah, I schooled you on that. I don't even know why.
Well, the main thing about it was
so
like
difficult with it.
I don't like platformers that like predicate on you dying to like figure out how you're supposed to do it. And maybe I just wasn't on my game that day, but I felt like it was really hard.
I think you just suck. I liked it a lot.
No, I really enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong. I'm definitely gonna buy it. I'm gonna play it.
Yeah, you're gonna pick that up? I might pick it up too.
Oh,
I'm kinda excited.
Yeah, dude. Maybe there'll be a...
Was that the diamond in the rough that weekend? I think it was.
No, I mean, that was definitely like the biggest surprise because I didn't really know anything about it. It's not actually going to be a launch game. It's slated for a 2014 release.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah.
Well, then, maybe there will be Kinect.
Maybe there'll be Kinect stuff. Maybe there'll be co-op stuff. Like, definitely, I think it has a lot of potential.
Absolutely.
And especially as an arcade game, very excited about it.
Oh, yeah.
These are the kind of arcade games that I want to see. Like, stuff that's new, like, creative, looks good. Like, because the game looked really good, too. Like, I didn't think the art style matched the gameplay, but...
I think it did. I mean, if it's going for, like... the kid experience, I guess. I don't know. But yeah, that was that game. Next game we're gonna talk.
Well, we're gonna talk about. You talked about Kinect integration into that game.
Yeah,
let's talk about
go
the
there.
You wanna go there?
So we got to play Kinect Rivals, right? Isn't that
Kinect
what it was?
Sports
it was a game. Which is it? Didn't it get that? That got delayed, didn't it?
Yep, it got pushed to 2014.
Yeah, so that's not even gonna be a launch game. I'm surprised it was there.
Well, not all the games were launch games because the Max Curse the Brothers.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's true. But we played a jet ski game, and I like what you said that it was a really bad example to play a game on the
Kinect. the thing about a jet ski is like there's really only two directions a jet ski can go. It can go straight, or you can pull hard like one direction. Like even driving the jet ski on a game as precise as Grand Theft Auto, you're really either going straight.
I'm gonna drive.
Yep, I actually am. You're actually going straight, or you're pulling hard.
So,
in a way, it's a brilliant game for Microsoft to show because you don't really know how precise the Kinect is.
Yeah, which is
like in a way, it's a really smart move for them because you're like you left saying, "Oh, it's really precise," and I was like, "Yeah, but we don't really know that because you know." Like, you got kind of caught in that little trap that they set for everybody.
Well, what I mean by precise is, like...
Like, the throttle thing?
The reaction, like, the delay was absolute zero.
Oh,
like, there
nothing.
Was no delay. It was fantastic. Like,
the jet ski game, the throttle, you actually pulled by just closing your fist.
Yeah.
So, like, it's...
And there was no calibration.
Tightly.
You know, it didn't have to read us for 15 minutes like the first Kinect does, you know? Stepped in, started playing. And then there's like a stomp feature, which like you didn't have to stomp like you didn't have to exaggerate it or anything, you know, you could just stomp it and then you
That actually did not work very well for me.
Really?
I don't know if it was because I'm so tall or like too far.
I tried doing it once too, but like my boost bar wasn't up all the way, so that can be an issue too.
Like they said, I didn't put my knee up. Like I'm apparently like she said tall people are having trouble with it because like there's some like differentiating between your foot. Like when you stomp it, that like my knee doesn't go up because I'm like it didn't think my knee was where it was. Basically, is what she said.
Oh.
Because I was like a taller guy.
Well, I didn't have.
But like. I'm sure, like as soon as you'll get used to it, it won't matter. Like, cause as soon as I like figured out the motion, it was fine. Like, as soon as I figured out that I had to raise my knee up a little bit, like I was fine the whole time. So,
I
was definitely impressed, but I'm gonna be like cautiously optimistic about like how it's gonna work for real.
Yeah,
like,
obviously,
know what I mean?
You know, if you get into a more Kinect, like if we're playing a Kinect-based game that relies a lot on precision, we can't tell you how well the Kinect's
exactly
gonna perform. But,
like
I
said, it was the perfect call for Microsoft to have us play that game because you really have no idea of how precise it is.
I mean,
it works
driving
good,
a jet ski, but
there's no lag, but you really don't know how precise it's going to be. I was very surprised that it was able to tell how far away my arm was, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because, like, the
fantastic.
Way the game works is you put your arms up, like, in front of your chest, and then you basically act like you're turning a jet ski. But there's, like, so... There must be a lot of sensors in it to be able to tell, like, that I'm moving my arm closer or further.
Yeah,
so that was kind of
impressive. It's definitely a huge improvement.
I think it's a great piece of technology. The only thing I'm so worried about with the Kinect is how are people going to use it.
Yeah.
I mean, we still haven't seen that, like, killer piece of software that everyone's going to be like, oh, that's what we're using the Kinect for.
Yeah, unless it's, you know, designed for the Kinect. We haven't seen any other integration.
Well, there's going to be integration with, like, the camera and the microphone stuff with, like, Dead Rising. But, like, that's just kind of a gimmick. I mean, that's kind of a gimmick, right? Like, it's going to be cool, don't get me wrong, but it's kind of a gimmick. So, that was our experience with the Kinect and our experience with Kinect Sports Rivals. What do you think of the game itself?
It was fun. I remember you making the comment that your arms got tired from riding a jet ski.
Yeah, I felt like super lazy. I was like, my arms are so tired.
But I mean that's good though, because then like maybe these games are actually gonna like do something for like, you know,
well,
people that want.
Well, the Xbox.
You know, like those,
I really wish Xbox fitness
that fitness stuff.
There.
Yeah, I've been. Good.
I would have liked to see that, but
it was fun. I mean. I don't know if I'm gonna go out and buy that game. That's just because that's not the type of game that I am, I guess.
Yeah, if you have young children or something, I think it'll be really.
They would have a freaking blast with it.
Yeah. Yeah, so that was a good game, I think. All right, so we have two games left. Which one do you want to end it on, Davis? Which one do you want to do next?
Dude, I don't know, man. These were both really good.
Yeah.
Let's talk date. Let's talk DR because we're picking up.
Okay. So my experience with Dead Rising 3, I pick up the controller and I'm kind of dropped into the middle of this street. Within the first, I played the game for probably 15 minutes, maybe. In that 15 minutes, I had driven a backhoe, a bulldozer, a motorcycle. I had wielded a flamethrower. I had wielded a souped-up nail gun. I had football zombies. I had blowtorched any kind of zombie you can think of, and I had killed over 1,000 zombies by the time I was done. The game is nuts.
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge improvement for Dead Rising franchise. It's a fun game. Here's my experience. So we played the same demo. I kind of cheated, because I watched IGN play this exact demo. And what I did was I drove the backhoe, I drove the roller, steam roller, whatever you want to call it. I ramped an SUV off of a ramp on the street, and then I took a street bike, drove it up the stairs of this hotel, and on top of the hotel there's a flashlight and some gems, and you can do a quick combine. I made a lightsaber, and before I went to face the zombies, I got into a medieval armor suit, so I was in this knight suit with a lightsaber cutting zombies in half, and then I managed to get another street bike and ramp off of that said hotel down into the horde of zombies. And there are just thousands of zombies on your screen at once. It's insane how many zombies there are. And yeah. Another cool feature I really liked about it was once you start killing a bunch of zombies in a row, there's a little thing pops up and you hit Y and B, and it does the execution on one of them, which is...
I wanted to bring that up. It's a really
DR2
cool, like, combo
did
system.
That.
Yep. You can unlock... By the higher your combo level gets, the cooler the execution you do is.
Yeah,
it's
so really cool.
It's really, really awesome.
Great feature.
I don't know why. This game just felt like it was paced so much better. Like, I literally felt like... there were so many zombies that I literally felt like I was fighting for my life. Where I
yeah,
don't really
absolutely.
Think you felt like that in the first two.
No, you were just...
Like, there wasn't
the
enough
first two was,
zombies to, like, make it feel like you were, like, literally in a zombie apocalypse. I felt like it was
the
just
first,
kind of like a sandbox.
The yeah,
two,
well,
this one actually feels like it's a zombie apocalypse. You're fighting for your life. Do whatever you can to survive.
The first two was more of a test against time and how well you can manage your time, really, than zombies. And there were just kind of, like, zombies in there. This one's really, like, holy shit, there are... thousands of zombies in front of me for the next vehicle. Some of my stuff is broken. How the hell am I gonna kill all these zombies?
I have to do whatever I can to get there. Like, that's
you know,
exactly
if that's,
how I felt.
You know, I'm throwing freaking garbage cans to clear out some freaking space. Like, that's what I'm
yeah.
doing. And the thing about that demo was we couldn't die, and we also started with a bunch of gear. So, like, even with all that stuff, we were already kind of like, holy shit, you know, how are we gonna kill all these zombies and stuff?
Yeah.
And it's like, just imagine when we drop into the game with a freaking hammer, and that's all we have. It's going to be nuts.
It's
going to be awesome. It's
going to be really, really fun. And very excited about the co-op stuff on that. We, of course, didn't get to try that, but, I mean, that is coming. Like, and that's just, it means it's going to be even funner with friends, just because it is such a ridiculous game. Do you think this is kind of going the way of Saints Row? I mean, this series.
No.
Doesn't it feel like that, though, where they're kind of trying to, like, up-one-up themselves with the ridiculous stuff?
No, because it's not obnoxious, though, right? It's not obnoxious.
Yeah,
like
that's fair.
Wielding a lightsaber killing zombie is completely different than a Matrix alien invading one. It's not a shooter. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah,
thank you for that. You knocked me in the water. Oh, this is beautiful right. down here. I've never been down here.
And now we got to talk about the last game that we played.
Holy crap.
It was probably... This, we talked about Max, the brother, being the gem. This actually might have been the gem, just because I wasn't expecting what it was.
Yeah, dude, it was definitely a shocker. Not gonna lie, it was I did not expect. Well, here's the thing.
You guys, let's wait. Let's just do this quick. You guys, Battlefield 4 on Xbox One is really good.
Yep, looks
a fantastic game.
Amazing.
Well, I don't even think it looked that good. The refresh rate on it.
You can't say it didn't look that good.
Well,
it looked good. I watched the tree.
All the games are going to look good, though. But the refresh rate is what killed me. Like, it looked good, don't get me wrong. But the refresh rate, the refresh rate on it was impeccable. It was probably running at 60 frames per second.
Yeah, easily. I watched a tree get derooted and fall over. And
really?
Right in front of me.
That's
yeah.
Amazing.
How
I
awesome
didn't
is that?
That?
Yeah, that happened to me. And then, like, I watched some dude shoot an RPG through a wall and only the part that, like, got punched out by the physical RPG because it didn't explode. It was just, like, a little thin piece of wood that he shot through to the ground underneath of it.
Yeah, that was really cool.
All that shit blow up next week. Awesome.
At one point, somebody was shooting a submachine gun through a, like, a wooden wall. And, like, just the way it broke apart, and it looked so realistic.
Yeah,
I've never seen a gun shoot through a wall, but if I ever did, I'm sure that's what it would look like. It looked immaculate.
Leave it to Battlefield. I had a blast. The shooting felt like Battlefield, but it felt a lot better. I was definitely happy with how the shooting felt.
Well, after the Battlefield 4 beta on 360 was so clunky,
oh my god,
and it looked
yeah,
terrible.
Dude. You think they
I
did
was
that
really
purpose,
not
right?
expecting much. It kind of makes you wonder, right?
Yeah, like, here's a pile of crap. Oh my god, played on next gen? Fantastic. Better not, like, I don't know. It was crazy. I did not expect it at all. It was awesome. I had a blast playing it.
It was fantastic. But, okay, so here's another thing. We played, like, a very controlled demo.
Yeah, it was a close quarter.
I wonder if that was actually online or if it was. I guarantee you they were system linked.
Yeah, I didn't experience any lag whatsoever.
Yeah,
was there even Wi-Fi in
that
building? It had to be system linked. Obviously.
So is it going to be as smooth of an experience if you're playing on
that's my only
concern.
Yeah, that's an issue.
You say that, but like sometimes I play GTA 5 with like big groups of races or something, and the frame rate will drop to like 12 frames a second.
Yeah, because we're still on a 360 server. Xbox One has 300,000 servers. I think we'll be fine. And it depends on your personal connection, too. Obviously.
Hey, can you come scoot me quick?
Are you, like, drowning? What's going on?
No, just come to the beach. But yeah, the game looked immaculate. It was super fun. I enjoyed it more than I probably ever have enjoyed a Battlefield game before.
That's because you also did really well.
I also did really well in, like, one of the biggest... Like, I'm not good at military shooters.
Why do I have a star on a jet ski?
Most surprising one of the things was that I did really well, so that was awesome. But yeah, no, I cannot say enough great things about Battlefield. I've been mainly a Call of Duty guy, but I gotta say it's kind of hard
yeah,
to
dude.
Get on board
is
with Call of Duty.
Your, is this a change?
They we haven't really seen Call of Duty that much, and I'm kind of worried because Battlefield looked immaculate.
I don't know I don't even know what I want to pick up anymore, dude. If Call of Duty looks that well, oh my gosh, it's gonna be insane on Xbox.
Call of Duty, that. If you're a Call of Duty fan, that might be the one reason to upgrade to the new Xbox, right?
Absolutely. If it looks that good, you do not want to be stuck playing Call of Duty on the 360.
Because,
You're going to kill yourself. You're going to want to kill yourself.
Battlefield 4 looked immaculate.
Yeah, I cannot wait. I'm really freaking stoked for next gen now. I think that's it. Do we miss anything?
We're
going to
actually run through some awards here at the end.
But that's all the games we played, right?
Yeah, I also quickly want to mention Zoo Tycoon.
Oh, yeah, forgot about that pop there.
It's, okay, stop, you're not the target audience for this. I thought it was actually kind of enjoyable. Like, I'm obviously not the target audience for this game either. But, I mean, it was what it was. I mean, it's a game for kids to, like, learn basic
math. It's
like
Sims with animals.
Yeah, it's Sim Zoo, basically.
Yeah.
Another thing about this game, another game we played that I just wanted to mention quickly as well, Skylanders.
Oh, yeah, dude, Skylanders was fun
We're
as shit.
We're both kind of impressed by Skylanders, right?
Yeah, dude,
it
looked
great.
Awesome.
It looked fantastic. Well, the cartoony graphics are always going to be easier to do in HD.
Yeah, I mean, it reminds me of a Ratchet & Clank type of game.
Yeah, it looked fantastic. The new characters, you can, like, swap the tops and the bottoms.
Swap
you can make like. You can make, like, weird combinations, like snake cats and stuff like that, and that was all really cool, and, like, they had different abilities, so it was really easy for people to do. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was really cool. Again, not the target audience for that game, won't pick it up, but doesn't mean it's not worth anybody's time.
How are we gonna do this fence? Nice. I think there's a door right there, but whatever.
So that was the game we played. Now we are going to run through just a few awards. We're gonna just hash these out. Davis, what game had the best graphics?
I want to give it to Battlefield. I think you're gonna go with FIFA.
I think I agree on Battlefield actually, because like
really,
FIFA we couldn't do the instant replay thing. Like what I really wanted to do is I wanted to put it in instant replay mode and zoom in super close and see. Like,
you wanna do a dogfight? What's dogfight?
Okay, these don't have guns, so
no. We'll just fly at each other.
Okay.
Move, asshole.
But FIFA, I would say it's Battlefield just because we know more about how Battlefield looks, and it looks fantastic. FIFA looks
freaking
good.
Awesome.
But we couldn't get in the instant replay mode to like zoom in on the faces or anything, you know, to see.
Yeah.
Like
and
sort of the jersey physics or anything like that, you know. Like we didn't. FIFA's zoomed out so far. Which is partially why I think NBA will probably be the best looking game, launch game. It's just because NBA is such a game that is so indicative to like zoomed in on your face. Like. We'll just have to wait and see, but that's my guess anyway. So we're kind of in consensus that Battlefield is probably the best looking game. That we saw anyway, from what we saw. Next, sort of award we're doing here is what gameplay felt like it was the most next gen?
Oh man, next gen.
Like what did you play that you went, oh, this is a next gen game? Like what?
It's a really
gameplay wise.
It's a really tough question.
And I'm gonna say, I actually have an answer for it. I'm gonna go ahead. Down here.
You go first.
I think Dead Rising 3 was just the amount of enemies and like the number of just how much stuff was going on. No, like the load times were really long on that, but like once you got in, like you were in. Like there was never any point where we had to hit a checkpoint or load or anything like that. And we don't know how that's gonna be in the real game for sure, but like. The amount of enemies, the amount of weapons, the amount of stuff going on, the amount of stuff that you could do so quickly and just at, like at your fingertips, I think it felt like the most next gen game. It didn't look like the most next gen game, but it definitely felt like the next gen gameplay.
I'll give you that. I'm going with Ryse, to be honest with you.
Okay.
Because how freaking smooth it was.
Yeah,
and the way it looked, and the like, there's even like those abilities that I didn't know about were on there, and
yeah,
just how
that was
and
cool
the load time, the load time was quick. It looked beautiful.
Ooh, it was quick for Xbox One standards, but people
really
are in for a rude surprise when they first play their Xbox One. The load times on all the games were kind of ridiculous, but. Again, we don't know if that was just the demos that we played or what.
Yeah,
that
just might just be the demo. Like, I don't know.
The next award we're going to give out is Biggest Surprise. We've kind of talked about this a little bit.
Battlefield.
I'm going to say it was actually Max Curse of Brotherhood. Because I didn't know anything about that game and I was really impressed with it. And it's probably something I'll pick up and play one day.
I got to go Battlefield just because of the demo.
Yeah, that was like that. I definitely was like,
I was,
wow! Like, I did not know that this was gonna be this way.
I was ragging on Battlefield 4, dude. I was ragging on it before I started playing.
The beta was so terrible.
I know, like, dude. It was a pile of shit.
it made you wonder, like, if
yeah.
you ever.
I was like, I was concerned about next generation after playing that one.
But it was so smooth in it. It sounded great. It looked great.
Dude, the sound, man. That was nuts. When I was shooting an RPG down a tube, I thought I was going to go deaf.
Yeah, definitely.
Awesome.
It's kind of upsetting that they're not going to have any headsets for it until 2014.
Yeah.
But
those were sick.
Yeah. It was fantastic. All right, biggest flop.
Biggest flop?
Yep.
Loco Cycle.
Yeah, I'm gonna say that too. I don't know what they're thinking with that game. Like,
yeah,
I don't
who,
like bag on it, but
Who seriously plays that? And it was like, man, this game, I'm having so much fun hitting X.
We've talked about this before. Like,
I don't want to talk about it anymore.
No, I mean, we've talked about this. This is just an idea of it, but, like, we've talked about this before. Like, at what point were they like, yeah, this will be an okay game to develop and, like, put a ton of money and time into?
Yeah, I don't
know. Like, who's playing that and is like, oh, this is a good game?
I don't get it. But, yeah, that was a flop.
And the next award is best game. Whole package, which one was the best?
Best game. You go. I want to hear yours.
For me, it was Dead Rising 3.
I'm going Ryse, dude.
Are you?
Yeah.
For me, it was Dead Rising 3 for one reason. If, like, to me, Dead Rising felt like it felt like a next-gen game. It felt like I wanted a next-gen game to feel like. Ryse looked, well, I considered Ryse as well, and although Ryse, like, looked great and felt great, it didn't break any ground. Like, it's not a groundbreaking game by any means.
I understand that, but, like, I don't necessarily need a bunch of stuff to enjoy games next generation. You know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't have to be super over the top. But I definitely agree with you on Dead Rising 3. That's definitely it. There's a lot of stuff going on, and it is a very ambitious game, especially for the Dead Rising series. And there is going to be a lot going on in the game. And I'm way excited to play with you. It's going to be a blast.
Yeah, and you've always been kind of a guy that goes for, like, those, like, sort of historical games, like, that hit a time period. Like, you
absolutely.
Like Assassin's Creed, because, like, all the history stuff in that, you like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I feel like that's I feel like it's the most, the game you could compare it the most to, as far as what game it, current gen game it most likely emulates, is Assassin's Creed on Ryse.
Yeah, I'd say I'm okay with that. Just like the hand-to-hand combat wise, it's obviously not a stealth jump off building assassinate type game, but
that's,
you know,
that's part of the reason I felt that I picked Dead Rising, is because every other game that we played you can compare to a current gen game, but I think Dead Rising is like a new experience.
Yeah,
because like it really doesn't feel like Dead Rising 2 at all.
No, it doesn't.
Whereas I think like Battlefield is kind of the same, like FIFA is the same, like all the other launch games are pretty much like games you've played before. But I feel like Dead Rising 3, like that constant run, constant motion, constant
and
like survival, like actually feeling like you're on the brink of death all the time. It's
and here's another thing.
Never really even seen in a game that's not Call of Duty or Battlefield.
And another thing is we didn't even get to use the off-screen phone stuff. Like, that's really going to push it to make it feel like a next-gen game,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, and it did. I'm surprised they didn't have any of the Kinect stuff, at least for us to demo, where we could, like, yell into the...
Yeah, dude. And, like, the flashlights and, like, the light sensitivity and stuff like that, that's all going
to
be in there.
And that, definitely, I mean, that was tough to do in the environment we were in, but...
Yeah, obviously, but definitely, it's definitely going to be a next... It's going to definitely feel like a next-gen game at launch.
It's going to feel like a next-gen experience. And I'm not sure you're getting that anywhere else, really. I mean...
No, you're really not.
They're gonna look better, obviously, but like, what other game are you seeing that you're seeing that you're like, where you're like, oh, this is a next gen game?
Yeah, like Dead Rising, you need to pick up. If you're getting an Xbox One, you'd be stupid not to pick up Dead Rising.
That's like that's probably the number one game I would recommend to people.
Yeah.
Like, as far as like, if you're buying this and you can afford one game, you're doing Dead Rising, just because it looks better than anything you're gonna see on the 360. Like, and I mean, it obviously doesn't look as good as like Battlefield or FIFA or Ryse, but it's next gen gameplay, and I think next gen graphics, at least what they're gonna look like for now until the developers figure out how to better use the system's resources.
Yep, DR4 could have some serious potential.
Dead Rising 4 is gonna be awesome. All right, do you have anything else you wanna like add?
No, we should probably wrap this up.
Yeah, definitely.
But get pumped for the next generation, guys.
Yeah, that was like the biggest thing to me. I don't know what I expected, but it was definitely like a big eye opener that like this is a month away. Like we're gonna be playing all these games in a month. They're gonna look better than anything we've ever played before. They're gonna feel different. Like even though
I want to say
enthralled with all of them, like do you think that the sort of like media scrutiny of the lack of a quality launch lineup is, now that we've actually played a lot of these games, is about right, or do you think it's overblown?
No, it was overblown before I even got to play it, and now it's just, you know, it's just like nail in the coffin for me. It's like
people are
stupid.
It's the Watch Dogs delay is a bummer.
Yeah, it's a huge bummer.
And if you're
especially if you're a
PS4 owner.
Yeah. If you're
getting a PlayStation 4 and you don't like... If you're getting a PlayStation 4 and you're not a Killzone fan, like, what are you playing at this point?
You have been playing Knack.
Well, you're playing Knack, or you're playing Assassin's Creed 4, which you can get on current-gen games next week. Current-gen next week. Or you're playing Call of Duty and Battlefield, which A, you can get on the current-gen, and B, you're going to be much better experiences on Xbox. Because everyone who goes to those games is getting an Xbox instead of a PlayStation.
Yeah, pretty much. There's one thing I want to say before we wrap up.
Yeah.
We bent the rules a little bit, and we hit the guide button, which was pretty frowned upon. And I want to throw this out to you, especially when I reached for my phone and when we were in a zone that clearly said no photos or videos.
But
I didn't see that. In my defense, I did not see that. Anyways, I want to throw this out to you. We're going to leave this on a little cliffhanger. Did it look a lot like Windows 8? Did it not? You got to admit that.
Microsoft, it did, but Microsoft actually came out and talked about that today.
Did they?
And they said that the Xbox One will not support Windows 8 applications. The fact that the idea that Windows can, or the Xbox One can run Windows applications is not necessarily true. They are looking into that, but they have no announcement at this time. That being said, it looked a lot like Windows 8. It looked like they built it. If it's not Windows 8 that is running on the consoles, it's something very, very similar that's built on the same
sort of structure. It definitely mirrors it. And I liked it. I liked the way it looked. I liked that as soon as I hit my guide, there was instantly a button that said achievements.
Yep.
Freaking fantastic. And then we got yelled at, and we had to put it away. But it
that's
was awesome
the,
from what we've seen.
The crazy thing is that no other sort of TV ecosystem has a true app store.
No.
Like, there are smart TVs that have apps, but none of them have, like, a true app store. And I think it'd be really interesting if Xbox, in sort of this effort to take over the media as, like, sort of being this entertainment hub of the living room, allowed developers to develop apps for the Xbox 360, like full apps, not like here's a dev kit that we're gonna allow you to change 15 things about, like full apps, because we could see some really amazing stuff, not just games, but like utility apps and other entertainment options.
Oh yeah, and like the stuff they're already talking about, like with the Kinect and being able to just slide like in between in and out of stuff, it's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be fantastic.
I'm very excited to see how the TV sort of integration works. Like, that's kind of the thing that's getting, like, pushed to the back burner. I want to know if I'm going to be able to play my 360 routed through my Xbox.
I don't think it's going to work. We'll throw a video
they
up.
They said that you can view it. So this is what Microsoft's official stance on it is. You can view it, but there's a little bit of a latency.
Oh, yeah. Because
if you're watching TV, it doesn't matter if there's lag because...
There's no input, it's just external.
But if you're trying to play a 360, it's going to be a little bit different.
You know what?
You know what'll be cool though? Just being able to watch Netflix on my 360 in the TV box of the Xbox. So I can seamlessly switch between Netflix.
There are so many.
I can pause a game and watch Netflix while the game is paused and then pop into the game.
That would be nice. But why don't you just use a Netflix X that launches with the Xbox One? You don't have to wire
your 360 through. Dashboard and...
No, you don't. It's got the picture-in-picture stuff. The sidebar stuff.
But I want
to
be able to
go
to Xbox
work.
TV and it'll go to my Netflix. It'll be awesome.
It will be awesome. So that's
get
what...
excited.
That
we're
pretty much wraps it up.
We're basically 1 month away. Let us know your...
Any questions, concerns?
Yeah, any questions, Q&A sort of thing. We will answer any other questions anybody has on our next week's show. Also, write to us and tell us what... Tweet at us at Main Street Gamers or write to us on Xbox Live. I'm Darth Paxton. Davis is Costly Davis. And let us know what your launch plans are. We're definitely excited to hear what everybody's planning on doing, what games people are getting excited about. Because we are 1 month away from the launch of the Xbox One. This has been Main Street Gamers Special Edition Xbox One Hands-On Impressions.